We're going to get started. Good morning, everybody. Since I put on my glasses, point south and north. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Joshua Brody. And the reason I invited him is because I was at a dinner, an annual dinner for the trustees, and he was invited to sort of speak to the trustees about his work. And when I think it was the dean or the president turned to him and said, "So, what's your goal? What do you think you'll accomplish here at Mount Sinai?" And he said, "I'm going to cure cancer." And I thought, "Oh, that's a pretty bold statement." That's I said, "We should invite him to Grand Rounds and hear how he's going to do that." So he and I have had a couple of exchanges by email, but he's an assistant professor of hematology and oncology and director of the Lymphoma Immunotherapy Program at Icahn School of Medicine. He received his MD from the State University of New York at Stony Brook School of Medicine, his BA in Molecular and Cellular Biology from Harvard University, and completed a residency in internal medicine at Yale, and his fellowship in medical oncology at Stanford. The research that he is conducting has been published in a lot of high-impact journals, including Blood and the Journal of Clinical Oncology, and he's received numerous awards. Dr. Brody was drawn to lymphoma, he says, because of the opportunity to work with a wide variety of people, which is also why many of us were drawn to family medicine, I think. There's so many unanswered questions in lymphoma, and Dr. Brody believes that patients need to find a physician they trust to come up with the best answers for them as individuals, and acknowledges that they're not only patients, but also people. The patient's always in mind when he's conducting his research, and his lecture will provide insight into current culture of cancer research and how family medicine providers can be involved in the future of these innovative treatment options. And having seen the slides, I'm already lost. So, Josh.
I haven't seen the slides yet, so I'm a little nervous hearing you say that. I hope they're not that complicated, because I may not be able to figure out what they mean, but we'll do it together. It'll be a group exercise. I'm excited to hear how great the slides sound. This is an actual patient. I'll tell you the truth. It's an actual patient that we're talking about. It's the silhouette of an actor, because they would not actually schlep my poor patient who lives a few blocks just north of here out to the West Coast where they get the best sunsets. But at least the concept is true. We did have this patient, John, who we treated on one of our clinical trials of a new immunotherapy, something that we invented here at Mount Sinai. And his tumors melted away, which was gratifying for us, but especially for John. This was on the back of the New York Times Magazine for every Sunday in February. So I eventually saved up some money and bought a copy of the New York Times, and then I scanned this in here. A lot more expensive than I remembered them being. So we're going to talk about something that is, you know, science fiction, impossible, you know, very theoretical, and also we're using it every single day in this building, and it's helping our patients live longer and happier. So it is very gratifying, because Neil was telling me a story about how, you know, was it 5 years ago when you were in residency? 7 years ago when you were in residency, or even just prior, so 8 years ago. Science and medicine were spheres and never betwixt, that you would never see them come together. And we are literally doing stuff in the lab in the fifth floor on Hess that we are then bringing downstairs to the third floor and treating our patients with. We don't use the same syringe, that would, you know, not be, but the same exact idea. So it is very gratifying to be in a time when we're actually getting to think up ideas, test them out, make them better, and then bring them to our patients. And sometimes, not always, but sometimes have them work. This is to remind people, because sometimes people forget, that New York City is beautiful if looked at the right angle. We tried every possible angle. This is the right angle. There's no other angle at which it's beautiful, but I recommend anyone that wants to borrow one of my helicopters to pop up there and check out New York City. It really is beautiful. I think this was from Ken Davis's helicopter, probably, after that Board of Trustees meeting. And to point out that this idea is something we're actually doing every day in the clinic. We all have immune systems. The immune system, although we, I don't know, sometimes hear this on Oprah or something, it was not designed to keep our cancers away. It was designed to just get us to reproductive age and then, you know, let us die at the ripe elderly age of 29 or whatever. But we don't need to go on what you know, God or Alanis Morissette's purpose was for our immune systems, we can make our own purpose for the immune system. She played God in an old movie. Two of you saw that movie. I can see by the nods, yeah. So I'm going to give you the kind of basic way we think about immunotherapy so you can talk about this because your patients are already asking you these questions. I saw this in the New York Times. I saw this in that journal. I saw this on the Meredith Vieira show. Is that a thing still? I think I saw that in a taxi. So they're asking me these questions, and now we can all hopefully answer them on the same page. We have two types of immunotherapy, passive and active immunotherapy, very different ideas. These are just using immune molecules or immune cells that already know how to kill cancer and putting them into us and letting them go and kill cancer. The person's not required to do much of anything other than get an infusion. Active immunotherapy is teaching the person's own immune system how to go and kill their own cancer. So the metaphor of giving a woman a fish versus teaching her how to fish, my 12-year-old niece reviews all of these slides before I present them, and it kind of helps with the political correctness of the slides, so I'm very lucky to have her on the team. She's very smart. We now mix metaphors. We've got a fishing metaphor, so now we shove an automobile metaphor into there to make it weird. Active immunotherapy, we break down into different types. We think of the immune system as an automobile. It's not a bad metaphor. We can either push the gas pedals of the immune system. We can give people cytokines to make T cells, other immune cells, get activated. We can give them another class of molecules that won the Nobel Prize, so you're going to be required to memorize this for the test, TLR, toll-like receptor agonists. Just to be clear, there is a test at the end. I think you guys are aware of that. Yeah, that's fine. It'll be quick. It'll be at the end. Don't worry. You will keep your jobs if you... No, you do great. Toll-like receptor agonists that turn on other types of immune cells. Gas pedals, brake pedals are probably the most famous things now because our immune cells all have brake pedals to avoid autoimmunity in us. And we found out recently that if we cut some of those brake pedals and free up the immune cells to do the job they were already set to do, we can get great anti-cancer effect, giant tumors melting away and people living for long times. And then, you know, I feel like if you live in Nebraska, this is all you need in a car, gas pedal and a brake pedal. But in Manhattan, you'll see that it actually makes a big difference if you can actually also move the car around from side to side. And that is not just making the immune cells go faster or slower, but telling them where to go. And that is the purpose of vaccines and kind of the focus of our research. So I'll hopefully get a little time to talk about that. Because I have a fishing metaphor and an automobile metaphor, I went to a website called google.com. I don't know if you guys have seen it. It's just incredible. This website has everything. And we're going to put a link to it, I guess, on the Family Medicine homepage. So if you guys have questions, it's just google.com. I mean, that's all you need. There's HTTP, but I think you don't even need that part, probably. Anyway, I typed in fishmobile, and I got a picture of one. So anything you need, it's there. I'm going to encourage you guys during the course of the lecture to observe that I speak at what we refer to as New York pace. I lived in California for 9 years, so I can speak clearly and slowly. I just don't prefer to. Therefore, you should interrupt me and ask me questions as I go. If I am unclear, if I am clear, but you just want to talk, and don't be shy to. The reason you should do it is because this room has a certain number of people in it, and a given fraction, about 11 to 12% of them are afflicted with shyness, and it's a tragedy. I've suffered from this same thing myself, as you can imagine, and you are doing them a great service by asking me the same question that they are thinking, but they're not able to ask it. You are, I don't want to be dramatic, but an American hero at that point, you know, saving the life and happiness of other Americans. So please interrupt me as we go. I will try to even encourage you as I go, perhaps. We have more endorsement of the concept of asking questions during a lecture, and so you should realize that this is something that you should be comfortable with. This is New York. If you're not comfortable, so you know, you should be. So this is a hard question, which I may or may not be able to answer. What does the research world look like for cancer research now? And I mostly want to reemphasize and triply emphasize the same point that it is awesome that we can do science and then it helps our patients. You guys had to memorize the Krebs cycle, and I apologize. I didn't enforce that. But you don't get to use that science every day. I'm sure you have tons of patients with McArdle syndrome or von Gierke's something or other, or Pompey's something. But other than that, I don't think you're using that science every day. This is science that we use every day for our patients. It's gratifying. This is going to make the point that we have three types of passive immunotherapy: antibody therapy, T-cell therapy, and this fancy new thing called chimeric antigen receptor T-cell therapy. And the point is that they all end up killing cancer in the exact same way. I'm going to talk about cancer, but a lot of these great stories are all in the field of lymphoma, which is lucky because it's the only cancer I know about. So that works out well for me and for you guys if you have hard questions. We're going to show you that antibodies, T-cells, and CAR T-cells all kill cancer by, at the end of the day, recognizing the cancer and then just spitting out either cytokines or effector molecules that literally make holes in cancer, and granzymes go into those holes and kill the cancer cell from the inside. And this is great because this is a very different way of killing a cancer cell than, you know, chemotherapy A, chemotherapy B, and C. Once you have a cancer cell that has learned how to outsmart chemotherapy A, it has learned a few tricks that will also help it to outsmart chemotherapy B and C. So it's really nice, instead of, we say, banging on the front door of that cancer cell over and over with the same chemotherapy, to really be able to go around to the side window or the back door and kill cancer cells in a very different way, which they have not learned how to defend themselves against. Ultimately, these three types of passive immunotherapy kill cancer cells the same way. I'll just talk about antibodies for a little bit, and we have this natural killer cell here because these do a lot of the effector work of antibodies killing cancer. Antibodies recognize cancer in a magical way, the same way that antibodies that we are making every day recognize influenza or pneumonia, streptococcus pneumonia. But they don't usually kill cancer cells by themselves. They usually kill cancer cells by recruiting an effector cell. NK cells are a common one amongst those. This is definitely on the test because we don't have to know every little tidbit and date of science, but I think we made a decision to try to remember these people that win Nobel Prizes. Many of them have earned those prizes, and you know, at least we got to memorize something. And these guys are worthy of remembrance, Drs. Milstein and Kohler. They got the Nobel Prize in 1984 because they invented a way of making lots of antibodies. They didn't invent antibodies, right? Alanis Morissette invented antibodies, but they invented a way of making many more, or whatever you believe. But they invented a way of making more of them, which is resulting in the fact that we use antibodies every single day. Every time you send blood tests down to the lab, all of those ELISAs, all of that flow cytometry, that is a lot of the blood tests you send are using antibodies. Without these guys, we would not be running those tests. And then, of course, as importantly, we're using antibodies for therapy every day in this building, in the next building. So I'll just give you the one-liner of how these guys invented this thing called hybridoma technology so we can make lots of antibodies. Very simple idea. We have B cells that make antibody against something we want the immune system to hate, but they, you know, just make a little bit of it, and B cells don't live forever. So they fused, they made a hybrid of that cell and another cell. So there were two magical things about that other cell. Number one, it was a cancer cell, irony of ironies, so that that antibody-making cell could now live forever, even in a test tube, and keep making antibody forever. And that cancer cell was a certain kind of cancer whose whole job is to make antibody all day. It was a myeloma cell. Myeloma is a cancer of plasma cells. Plasma cells' whole job is to make antibody. So this cancer just sits there and makes antibody, and now it makes the antibody you want it to make. So they hybridize these two cells together, the B cell with the antibody you want, the myeloma cell with the ability to live forever and make a lot of antibody, hybridize them. Now you have kilograms and kilograms of the antibody you want. The antibody you want for us are antibodies that go and recognize cancer cells and get the immune system to kill them. So that was awesome, even though that, you know, really was invented 10 years before the Nobel Prize. It still took us many, many years to get those antibodies into humans. The first problem was that B cell and that cancer cell were both from a mouse. So when you put those mouse antibodies into people, it can work once. But if you try to give that a second time, that's a big problem. We have now developed anti-mouse antibodies in us. You can't give a mouse thing twice. It's amazing you can even give it once. But you give it once, it lasts for a little while, and now we have immune responses against giving more of that. So we had to develop some technology to make those mouse antibodies look mostly human. And nowadays, those antibodies look entirely human. We literally have, I'm sure this is somewhere on South Park, little mice running around that are humanized mice. Don't feel for them. They have great, I would say, great lives. I mean, we see them, they look genuinely, as best I can tell, they look happy. And why I say that is because they don't have, you know, thrones and caviar, but they get to hang out with each other all day. They're just, you know, all cuddled in together, and that's what they're into. So don't feel too bad. They're doing pretty well, better than some of us. So we're working on it. That though, I'm going to be huddled together with people soon. So anyway, we have hybridoma technology. It is, I don't want to be dramatic, but a miracle, I would say, because it was invented by people, and that's pretty great that we can invent stuff. So we have antibodies, we use them to treat people. Is this instead of chemotherapy? Is this complementary to chemotherapy? Answer can be both, but when you see this font, that means to you that good data is coming up. The New England Journal of Medicine, you may not realize, has purchased its own font. This is not Calibri, this is not Arial, this is definitely not Helvetica. I can't even say Helvetica without feeling a little. This is a font that you cannot get on Microsoft Word. Even if you have a Mac, you still cannot get this font because New England Journal of Medicine made it and paid for it. You can, you know, cut one letter at a time out of the New England Journal like a kidnapping person, but you otherwise can't use this font. And we now, you know, in our cerebellums associate this font with high quality data. Okay, it's not always high quality data, but frequently it is. And this is high quality data showing that an antibody plus standard chemotherapy for the most common type of lymphoma called diffuse large cell lymphoma, 25,000 Americans every year getting this diagnosis, and previously, up until 2002, getting a approximately 50% cure rate. This is a cancer that we can treat, and up until 2002, we could cure it about half the time. Now we cure it about 60%, or actually 61% of the time. So this is not making people live a little longer. This is, oh, not to make enemies with my nephrology friends, but this is not dialysis that just stretches out your life a little bit. This makes you be cured. And if you get this lymphoma when you're 50, God willing, you get another 50 years. So that's a big deal. And antibodies plus chemotherapy together are how we accomplish that. There are some antibodies and other immunotherapies that we use by themselves as monotherapy, but this is even more common in oncology, chemotherapy plus antibody therapy. You can ask, when will we get the antibodies good enough that we can get rid of the chemotherapy? We actually are working on that. I'll give one example. But so far, the paradigm is using these things together, immunotherapy plus standard therapies. This is a picture of many, many ways, I won't go through it in detail, of how we can make antibodies better, and not just an idea, but things we're actually doing. We can take antibodies and attach a little chemotherapy piece to their tail end. We can attach radiation to their tail end. We can attach little vesicles filled with whatever we want. And we have these in the clinic now. We have antibody drug conjugates. It's a whole class of medicines, ADC, antibody drug conjugates. And they're kind of elegant. Instead of chemotherapy pumping it into the whole person, you target that chemotherapy directly to the cancer cell, and then it gets infused straight in, and we hopefully give the person all the benefit of chemotherapy without, I'm going to say without any of the toxicity, or with a greatly reduced amount of toxicity. We can make antibodies better in these ways. We can make antibodies better by making them bind more tightly or have more of the target. I told you that the effectors of antibodies are not usually the antibody itself, but another immune cell which comes by and helps that antibody to kill, so we can rev up those effector cells, like NK cells, with different cytokines that make them work better. There's lots of ways that we can make antibodies better, and we are. Antibodies are, of course, in many cases, FDA-approved standard therapies, and some of these things are as well. We have FDA-approved standard antibody drug conjugates for breast cancer, for lymphoma, and some of those are helping to sort of get rid of chemotherapy in those settings. That's all I will say about antibodies. If you guys have questions about antibodies, you should ask me or email me. If you saw my name, that would be helpful in trying to email me. If not, figure something out. No, I'll tell it to you again at the end. I'm going to tell you briefly about T cells, because this is somewhere in between science fiction and reality. We have T cells that are making cancer melt away, but we don't have them as a standard FDA-approved product yet. So I'll just give you one drastic example, and it's drastic because I realize they are serving breakfast outside here, and I apologize that you ate some of that and now we're going to see some of this, but your doctor, she's seen much grosser stuff than this. So let's start the day fresh. These are gigantic melanoma tumors, one in a patient's neck, another one in the back of a patient's head. These melted away by virtue of giving these patients anti-cancer T cells. Where did they get those anti-cancer T cells from? They do not have them at Walgreens, unfortunately, yet, but they got these in a magical way. These are called tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes. They actually cut out people's tumors, find the small number of immune cells that are in the tumors. Many of them are T cells. And the supposition was, this is all mostly done at the NIH, and they've been doing this for 15, almost 20 years now, and with some drastic success. If they figure that T cell was in the tumor, there's got to be a good reason for it. Maybe it was an anti-cancer T cell, but it just kind of lost its, I'll pick a noun, verve, or lost its ability, it lost its vim and vigor. I think that was a brand of milk at some point. It lost its ability to kill cancer cells for some reason. We don't know what that reason was, but at least it had the ability to recognize those cancer cells. So if we just take it out, rev it up in a test tube for 6 weeks or 8 weeks, then we could just put it back in the person. Now it'll do the job it was already intending to do but unable to do. And that is what they did. They took these tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes out, rev them up with some things that T cells like, cytokines, in the test tube. When they gave them back to people, it had a remission rate of about 30%. That was pretty good. And then they learned a very, I don't know, surprising but awesome lesson that there's a metaphorical space competition within all of us for the amount of T cell food within our blood. So if you have to compete with all the other T cells that are already in you, T cells that we put into you don't have as much space to do their thing. If we get rid of all the T cells in you for a little while and then put those T cells in, so we give some chemotherapy, T cell deplete you, and then put in those T cells we had in the test tube, now these T cells get much more excited, much more able to kill cancer. And instead of getting remission rates of 30%, we get remission rates of 50%. If we really give you mega dose chemotherapy and then put those T cells back inside of you, they get revved up incredibly. And these trials showed a 75% remission rate. That is unheard of in melanoma oncology for sure, just about in any type of cancer. So the punchline is here that T cells can awesomely get rid of cancer. I mean, before these pictures came out, and these pictures were coming out in the early 2000s, there were two schools of thought. Immune cells can kill cancer, and the other school, grow up people, you're living in a fantasy land. Those were the two schools of thought. And now there's one school of thought. T cells can kill cancer, period. There's not a debate. There's only a debate of how to make it happen more in everybody, how to make it feasible, because this taking out every person's tumor, doing this 8-week process in a test tube is undoable. We cannot mass produce this. One company is trying to, but we need to make this more readily practicable, and that's what a lot of cancer immunotherapy is working on now. And the truth is this awesome approach worked mostly for melanoma, didn't work as well for other cancers, so we need to make this work for other cancers as well. It's just, yeah. Yes and no. This is Steve Rosenberg. He is the most published PubMed person in the history of this planet. I can't speak for other planets, but you know, a lot of that is because some of those patients were, and we're always shy to say it, but they were cured. They were not treated, and then their disease relapsed. And I don't have an exact fraction because these are small trials, but you know, maybe almost half of those patients that got those remissions, more than half of those patients that got those great remissions were cured, meaning that 10 years later, because you saw that's 2002 data, a lot of those patients, their cancer never came back. But yes, some of them do have relapses, and we have some interesting knowledge now of why they relapsed, and we can address that a little bit in this, in one more slide, a couple more slides. Was there another question? Okay, if they come up in faraway places, you're gonna tell me. Okay. So, and again, some oncologists are, you know, even shy to say this word cure, because then you have other people trying to impress the media by using the word too easily. And then we set up a jetpack scenario where in the 1970s we were promised jetpacks by the year 2000. We never got them. And now we look at scientists like, what the hell? Where's the moving sidewalks? Where's the jetpacks? You're a bunch of liars, but you're lying for the sake of, you know, getting your own career moving forward faster. So don't oversell it. And some scientists have oversold it, but those people were cured because more than 10 years later, their disease did not come back. And unfortunately, that is, we define cure not by any fancy PET scan, by any fancy CAT scan, by any fancy blood test. We frustratingly define cure by the test of time. And that's why sometimes 1 year after a remission, we're still shy to say someone is cured, because no scan or blood test is the perfect test. Only the test of time is perfect. So sometimes it takes us a long time to use that word.
I think this is a little more of an area of cure, but you know, if you think of cancer as a chronic illness, that's I think where there's some sort of confusion, because you still need surveillance. And so I you know, it's like living with the post cure.
Yeah, but we work on both paradigms. We have a fraction of patients who, as of today, we say you have a potentially curable cancer. some of these lymphomas, some leukemias, and we don't tell them they're cured on the day they get their remission. In fact, that semantics is horrible. We say the word partial remission, complete remission, and complete remission sounds like cure. I mean, just that's what it sounds like, but it's not. It's a technical word we use to mean we cannot see any evidence of your cancer on all these tests, but it doesn't promise you're cured. Only the test of time promises that. But in different cancers, we have different promises. In certain cancers, we say, if it didn't come back in 2 years, you're cured. In another cancer, if it doesn't come back in 10 years, you're cured. But yes, that is one paradigm, and we have a whole other paradigm of living with cancer for cancers that in 2017, we say, we cannot cure these yet, but we can make you live for 20 years. And if you're 70, well, you know, it's not so bad. And so that is a paradigm for some of the most common cancers. Certainly some breast cancers, the ones that I treat a lot of, CLL, the most common leukemia. If you know an 80-year-old, you know somebody with CLL. That's a bit harsh. But you know, a huge fraction of older people get CLL, 130,000 Americans walking around with CLL today. And we do not cure that disease, but we make them live for hopefully 20 years. And nowadays, with some new therapies, even longer. So yeah, it's a split paradigm depending on which cancer we're talking about and depending on the year. Because I, in terms of semantics, in terms of giving people information, but also giving them hope at the same time, hopefully in the same sentence, I always say to patients, we cannot cure this cancer yet. I don't say to people, we can't cure this cancer. I always put yet in there, because my grandpa's sister died of Hodgkin's lymphoma in 1958, and now that is a 70% curable cancer. But in 1957, we said, we can't cure this cancer yet. It was true. Now we can. And we have a very plain vision of that for most of the... I mean, these are not like rosy-eyed, optimistic, oncologist or all optimist kind of people. Some of us are, but we have a plan to get rid of these. We tire of this. We'd rather just, you know, blood pressure and diabetes be their chronic disease. Because, you know, we have golf dates we need to get to. We have, you know, stuff, I mean, not me, because I don't know how to do that, but. So anyway, we have T-cell therapy for other types of cancer as well. This is T-cell therapy for lymphoma. I'm gonna skip it for the sake of time and just say, we have T-cell therapies, but we can't get them at Walgreens yet. And this is one that is now right in between science fiction and reality. We do not have an FDA-approved CAR T-cell, but later on this year we will, and that will be cool because it will be transformative again. And the reason it's cool is because I think we are, with these therapies, and I'll tell you what they are in it right now, are curing some patients, not just making them live longer, but making their cancer be a memory. And one reason we're doing it, and you can kind of get a hint of that here, is that we're not just giving people pills, we're giving them something called living medicine. These are living cells, just like when you give someone a kidney transplant, you're giving them living medicine. It's an organ, it lives in you. These are cells that in many cases live in you, you know, for months or years, or perhaps even much longer. And this sort of is getting back to the concept of maybe living with cancer, but you don't have to take a pill every day because we gave you the pill once and the pill is living in you, which is a little scary. But these were cells that came out of you and then went back into you. Chimeric antigen receptor cells, let me tell you why they got that name. These are in, you know, not just the New England Journal of Medicine and the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times. These were on Howard Stern, literally, on an episode a couple years ago because of how weird and cool they are. Howard Stern had them on here because the way we get this magical gene that we invented into the cells is we use a lentivirus or retrovirus, so a cousin of HIV. So you can imagine Howard had a field day with this. Let me get this straight. You got people that got enough problems already. They got leukemia, and you're giving them HIV. And then the scientist said, no, that's not, you're not getting it right. But we actually do use weird-sounding technology to make this real. So what is this? This is a chimeric antigen receptor. What's an antigen receptor? An antibody is one type of antigen receptor. It's a B-cell antigen receptor, but then you spit it out, no longer on the B-cell anymore. And T-cell receptors are an antigen receptor. And this is a molecular chimer of the two of them, where you ripped off the genes that make part of this antibody, and we use that to recognize a cancer cell, or for example, a cell that has something we can recognize on it, like a lymphoma cell that has these markers called CD19 that's not on the test. I mean, it might be, we haven't decided yet. It might be on the test. So we use part of a B-cell receptor, and then to activate the cell that it is shoved into, we use parts of a T-cell receptor. You can see by the coloring, parts of the T-cell receptor to send this activation signal to what was your own T-cell, and then part of these other molecules on T-cells that also send a signal to turn on T-cells. So we literally glue those into one gene. That gene sits in a virus. We take out, these are examples of how we've made those genes at Sloan Kettering, at NIH, at UPenn, now at 10 other places. We are just opening our first CAR-T trials here at Mount Sinai just now. And this is what we do. We have the person give blood for a few hours. We apherese them. It's not too big of a deal. This has been done to me a few times now. We activate their T cells, and then we put this new gene into those T cells. This is a gene which recognizes the cancer with an antibody piece and then turns on the T cell with a T cell turning on molecule. That is the CAR. The gene is the CAR, and when we shove it into a T cell, now we call it a CAR T cell. We expand those CAR T cells, and before we put them back into the person, we give them, as I just hinted before, some chemotherapy to make space for those new magical anti-cancer T cells to expand when they get inside. And these are just a few awesome examples of how well they work. This is a person that, looking at a CAT scan across the top of the chest, trachea, backbone, ribs, axillae. I frequently talk to scientists a lot, and they say, wait, you cut that person transversely? I say, no, it's virtual. It's not like the magician with the box lady. This is just you were just looking inside of them. No one was hurt. Not really. So they have giant tumors in their axillae, as you can recognize. These are all CLL tumors. 30 days after their CAR T cells, they're shrinking. 3 months later, they are just about gone. And some of these patients, 5 years later, their tumors are still completely gone. And some of these first patients from 2011 have had New York Times spreads and other stories to tell, because CLL is a cancer of 60-year-olds, but we are also using these therapies for ALL, frequently a cancer of 3-year-olds and 10-year-olds. So you see some of those kids getting their own stories in the New York Times now, and definitely deservedly so, because they went into a clinical trial and experiment and came out, 5 years later on the other side doing awesomely, doing very well. So these are CAR T cells getting rid of CLL even 5 years ago. This is an even more usually deadly lymphoma, diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. These are PET scans, so you don't have to be a radiologist. Bright is uptake of sugar, so cancer, lymphoma all around the sternum. In another patient, cancer throughout their liver and their retroperitoneum. Another patient, cancer taking over their whole spleen. And months or even years after their CAR T cells in remission, this will become an FDA-approved therapy, I don't know, June, sometime later this year, because of great data like these. You can recognize that font is a fancy font. I'm going to probably skip these other ones. These are CAR T cells. As you saw, we usually make them from the person's own immune cells, but we can also sometimes get them from another donor, an allogeneic CAR T cell instead of an autologous CAR T cell. I'll skip it for the sake of time. They give cutesy names for all these, donating used CARs. And they have armored cars and side cars. They have every cutesy thing. Marketing is a huge part of science, as you probably realize already, because if you can't sell it, yes, science is expensive, as you know. I will move forward a little bit to the third part of the automobile. To the three parts of the automobile. CAR T cells, I've been thinking about a question that Neil asked me. Are these going to be available to poor people, to everybody, to all Americans? I think so. I have not been an internist since I worked in New Haven for a few years, and there everyone was on Medicaid, and at least all the patients I saw were on Medicaid, and I thought Medicaid was the best insurance that ever came through our clinic because it was the only one that paid for Tylenol. And we, in our clinic, see every, I don't even know what insurance people have because I just know we take all of them. I don't know if that's not true of maybe every clinic in Mount Sinai even, but in terms of getting these medicines paid for, the answer is yes, we do not see problems, but I should point out that medicine is super expensive medicine. Arguably, the people that make it would say this is that medicine instead of a stem cell transplant, which is, for a simple autologous transplant, 100,000 easily a pop, for allogeneic transplants, 400,000, and that's kind of like the base price without the rims and the fins and I don't buy cars a lot, so whatever else you can put on top of a car, the rust plating that goes underneath, the weatherproofing. So those things are expensive, stem cell transplants, and these things are going to be priced just to be less than those things. They are going to be expensive. Medicaid people will get them. Forget Medicaid people. We have a lot of patients who are prisoners that come in their orange jumpsuits. I don't know what you call that insurance, but whatever it is they have. And we give them all these medicines too. Although transplants are hard with prisoners because they have to be here for a long time. And then you're paying not for the transplant, but for the security guard and the cop to sit there with them for weeks and weeks. So I think that these things will be available. We will, as an American medical system, go bankrupt very soon. I'm not sure if that was clear to you all. I think that should be clear. I'm learning Mandarin, and it is a difficult language. But when our Chinese overlords take over, I'm going to do quite well. I hope you guys are learning Mandarin. So I guess that's assumed. I don't have a solution to that. This is not helping that problem. These things are expensive. If they stretch out your life by a few months and cost $250,000, we have to have a fight about that. If they cure you of cancer and you get another 50 years, I don't think we have a fight about that. I think we should cure people and let them live their lives. And sometimes they live their lives better after they've had cancer and gotten cured, or at least that's what we see. Okay, I'm going to talk about teaching people's immune systems to kill their own cancer. This is meant for the purpose of memorizing every detail of molecule by molecule. No, it's meant to impress you that there are many molecules on our immune cells, our T cells especially, that decide whether they are on or off. And cancer cells have co-opted a lot of those tricks to try to turn off our immune cells, to try to avoid turning them on. The purpose here, we use this automobile metaphor, gas pedal, brake pedal, you know, maybe that's it. But really, it is a piano's worth at least of pedals. So you can imagine driving that automobile, if you were anything other than, you know, Ludwig von Beethoven, is going to be difficult to do it well. So that's what we are working on. You know, if it's just a gas pedal and a brake pedal, how come you guys haven't gotten it done yet? Well, we are working on it. It's actually a bunch of pedals, and that's been our slowing us down a little bit. But we are making some real progress. I'll show you some pictures of that. I was so excited that this was still there. So this is an example of gas pedals. We can pour cytokines into people, IV, other ways, and try to rev up their immune cells. And recognize one thing about this slide, that all of these fonts are disgusting. They are terrible. Well, blood's okay. This one's not. It's almost like Arial narrow. It's near Arial bold and Arial narrow. So this one's okay. But most of these are, and meaning that these are not published in the New England Journal of Medicine, therefore you're not required to know about them because they were not successful. It's making the point of just pushing a gas pedal on an automobile is not enough. There are some instances, if you pour tons of interleukin-2 into people, and they did this in this hospital, but really not anymore, you can cure a tiny fraction of melanoma patients because some people's anti-cancer immune system automobile is already pointed right at their cancer, and if you just rev it up enough, that's all you have to do, and it can kill some cancer cells. But that is the exception and not the rule. Just pushing on the gas pedal and pouring cytokines into people yields, you know, literally Calibri, Times New Roman, some of these horrible fonts, not New England Journal of Medicine, bad results. So don't do it, I guess, although people are still trying to do it today, but it's not so far been successful. That's one type of gas pedal, turning on T cells. We can try to turn on a different type of immune cell called myeloid cells, dendritic cells, monocytes, macrophages, things like that. And at least we have to acknowledge these guys that discovered these types of cells that can be turned on. Dendritic cells won the Nobel Prize in 2011 because they are the generals of the anti-cancer immune cell army. T cells are the soldiers, but who tells them what to do? That is these guys. They are the best at it. I won't go into the details of why, but that was acknowledged by Ralph Steinman, you know, even in the early 80s, late 70s, early 80s, and acknowledged by the Nobel Committee in 2011. This is a unique Nobel Prize since the 1970s when a rule was invented, because Ralph was the only guy to win the prize dead, because you're supposed to be alive when you win this prize, because this is not a posthumous prize. It used to be when they invented it, but in the 70s they made a new rule. Only living people get the Nobel Prize. They called Ralph on Monday morning to congratulate him. He had died a few hours before that, Sunday night, of pancreas cancer, which he was trying to treat himself with dendritic cells. And he did live a long time. He lived about 40 blocks south of here, so we remember him for his invention and for that dramatic story. But he won the prize along with these other guys, Drs. Butler and Hoffman, who discovered the best gas pedals for dendritic cells, which are called toll-like receptors. So, you know, who wins a Nobel Prize, like, de facto, it goes into the Trivial Pursuit card deck. You guys are going to be hanging out with some friends at a bar somewhere sometime, and these cards are going to come up out of the Trivial Pursuit card deck. Who are they going to look at? They're going to look at you. You know, memorize this or don't, but I'm telling you, it's going to be in your own favor, because they're going to say, wait, isn't this like what, like Nobel Prize of Medicine. Isn't that in your job title, medicine? So yeah, memorize these. These are worthwhile, either the guys' names or at least what they did. Dr. Steinman discovered dendritic cells. Drs. Butler and Hoffman discovered toll-like receptors. And toll-like receptors, and I say this more for this audience than almost any other audience I talk to, can be used every day in the clinic, because hardly any of my super specialist lymphoma talks know about this medicine, imiquimod. But you guys prescribe imiquimod because you have patients with HPV, then that's FDA approved for that. And imiquimod is a TLR7/8 agonist. And so you guys can use it every day. You know, you can refer them to derm, but I don't think for a wart you need to. I'm not telling you how to do your jobs. But it's a pretty easy medicine. We can turn on toll-like receptors with toll-like receptor agonist. Imiquimod is a TLR7 agonist. And when we turn on dendritic cells, they become better antigen-presenting cells and tell T cells really forcibly what to do, whom to hate, whom not to hate. And that turns on those T cells to go and do their job. I won't go into the immunology 101 of toll-like receptors, but we have about 10 of them in our bodies. They each recognize different things. They recognize things that look bacterial-like or fungus-like or protozoa-like. Viral-like. Here, most of the viral-recognizing ones. They don't recognize exact things the way our T cells and our immune and our antibodies do. They recognize things that look like bacterial-like, viral-like. Bacterial-like. What does that mean? Bacteria have some DNA in them that we have very little of, which is hypomethylated and has more CG repeats. It's just, I don't know, I don't really remember why that is, but they have more of that kind of DNA. So if you show a lot of that kind of DNA to an immune cell that has toll-like receptor 9 on it, it recognizes that kind of DNA. It doesn't have to be from a bacteria, but it's kind of bacterial-looking. So that turns on these dendritics to say, I think whatever we're seeing here looks like an infection, let's go and hate it, whatever it is, and then tell the T cells, if you're seeing something that you don't like, I am blessing you to go and try to kill that thing. So these are the generals. They are intuitive. They recognize viral-like, bacterial-like, fungal, protozoa-like milieus by virtue of these toll-like receptors. Toll-like receptors are expressed on many different cells, but dendritic cells express probably the most of them. And they recognize all of these different things, viruses, bacteria, fungi, and protozoa. And we have just poured these gas pedals, toll-like receptor agonists, onto people, either intravenously or in other ways, and recognize that these fonts are pretty schlock. So again, just pouring a gas pedal on doesn't do the job. Even ones that we use every day for getting rid of papillomavirus quite well. But again, just pouring the gas pedal on doesn't do enough. Except, here's an exception. If you again can pour the gas pedal on right to an anti-cancer immune system that's poised and ready to go, if you can co-localize the gas pedal and the cancer, and that's what this is here. These are people with skin lymphoma, mycosis fungoides, skin lymphoma, pretty common. And when they just poured, I can't remember if this was imiquimod or riziquimod, a very close cousin of imiquimod, they just poured it directly onto these lesions, and those people's immune systems got rid of their cutaneous lymphoma. In fact, it worked in the majority of patients pretty well. So the general rule is you can't push the gas pedal and expect the car to get where you need it to go, but if it's already right near where you need it to be, sometimes that can work. Much more famously in immunotherapy is this concept called cut the brakes, meaning that we have many gas pedals on our immune cells, we have many brake pedals. This is surprising, and I think for some reason the most memorable part of what I say, because I gave a lecture to the first year med students, and then I gave a lecture to second-year med students. I didn't realize it was the same med students. But right before I said this line, one of them yelled it out to me. I was like, how did you know what I was going to say? You lectured us last year. Oh, I didn't know you were the same people. So this was the line, is that immune systems, we have immune systems for one primary purpose. And then I paused there so people can kind of think in their minds, guess the purpose. To fight bacteria, to fight strep throat. No, that is not the primary purpose of our immune systems. The primary purpose of our immune systems is to not kill ourselves. Because we're, again, dramatically sitting on a nuclear silo of powerful stuff. Why? I mean, that's not obvious how powerful it is. But if you see a terrible, you know, lupus patient, you see how powerful the immune system is. If you see someone put in a bad kidney and how they can reject that in minutes to hours, you see that the immune system is pretty powerful. It can kill stuff powerfully. And it is miraculous that it is sitting in us all the time and usually chooses not to kill us. That's pretty good. I would personally be uncomfortable living on top of a nuclear silo and just hoping for the best. But, you know, in 99 out of 100 patients or 100 people, it usually does its job of not killing us. That is its first job. That is why it probably has more brake pedals. I'm not showing you the full repertoire of them, but more brake pedals on its surface than it has gas pedals. And we realized this over the past decade and have exploited it, because some of our immune cells are already set to kill cancer, but the brake pedals are preventing them from doing that. These are some of the most famous brake pedals. These are two, quote, unquote, FDA-approved brake pedals, meaning we can block them with FDA-approved medicines, and we have done so to great effect. These are, again, beautiful fonts. Oh, so delightful. And this is giving an anti-CTLA-4 antibody, something that blocks that brake pedal called CTLA-4. These are giving anti-PD-1 antibodies to people with cancer. You see this cancer is melting away in the majority of people, not in everybody. I could try to answer Neil's question about why some of these cancers seem to be coming back, but you see the majority of them are shrinking and staying shrunk for a while. So we have different types of, we call this field checkpoint blockade, blocking the checkpoints. The checkpoints are the breaks. So checkpoint blockade for PD-1, for the thing it binds on cancer cells called PD-L1, you can block either side of the equation, or blocking CTLA-4. These are FDA-approved medicines. We use them every day in the clinic. In fact, this class are even much more famous now because they are better than the first class, anti-CTLA-4, because they are even more potent, and this is a bizarre win-win in oncology. They are more potent and safer. There's an obvious potential side effect here. You are blocking the brake pedals of T cells, some of which could be anti-cancer T cells, but some of which are anti-liver T cells, anti-intestine T cells, anti-skin T cells, anti-lung T cells, and you sometimes give people autoimmunity by giving them these medicines. Frustratingly, with this first class, we were giving like 20% of people significant autoimmunity, autoimmunity that might end you up in the hospital. Intestinal colitis is the most famous example. And then with this newer class, we're giving, 5% or less hospitalizable autoimmunity, but maybe we're giving 1% of people horrible autoimmunity. Bad, but good for the other 99 people, but bad for that one person, but still a great improvement. And these anti-PD-1 antibodies are now FDA approved for 12 kinds of cancer. I'm exaggerating slightly, but like 6 kinds of cancer with 6 more on the way. When Jimmy Carter got metastatic melanoma in his brain, this is what went into Jimmy Carter. And you can be a fan of Jimmy. You can think he's just a peanut farmer and shouldn't be a, anybody, whatever you think, it's a pretty good medicine. And he's doing well, thankfully. I'm not Jimmy's doctor, so it's not a HIPAA violation for me to say that he's doing well. The most drastic story, delightfully to lymphoma docs like me, is that this anti-PD-1 antibody works well in melanoma, 40% remission rate, pretty good in lung cancer, 20% remission rate, but amazingly well in Hodgkin's lymphoma, somewhere between 65 and 90% remission rate. This is, again, a beautiful font, and you saw 87% of people getting remissions who had Hodgkin's lymphoma. Hodgkin's lymphoma is one that we especially want to get rid of because we cure some of it with chemotherapy. We cure 2/3 of it. And because of that, we're a little cocky. The person walks in with Hodgkin's lymphoma and we say to them, we're going to cure you probably. But they don't hear the probably. They just hear we're going to cure you. And so therefore, we probably shouldn't have said it like that. And then, 30% of the time we don't. And now we feel especially bad because we feel like we lied to them. So when we get new medicines that are awesome for those patients, weirdly, it makes us even happier. Although, right, we should be focusing on lung cancer because that's what's killing most people. So we're very lucky to have these cut the brake pedals. It's just one more example. I'm going to skip these other examples of cut the brake pedals. I'm going to give maybe one quick example of vaccines, the steering wheel of this anti-cancer immune automobile, trying to tell the immune system, don't just go faster, don't just remove your brakes and be disinhibited, but specifically go after this thing. And this is something where we've had less FDA approval success. We have one FDA approved cancer vaccine for prostate cancer, but it's not very good, so it's not used a lot. The company went bankrupt. We're not supposed to talk about money in here. But we are working on making this better. So this is how we are working on making this better. We try to cheat. A vaccine, flu vaccine, pneumonia vaccine, hepatitis B vaccine, they're all the same concept. They're taking an antigen you want the immune system to hate, and they're putting some immune stimulant together with it and injecting that into the people. Usually we put those two things together in a factory, the hep B surface antigen and some mild immune stimulant, put them together in a factory, put them in a bottle, ship it out, inject it into the deltoid. For cancer, it's a little trickier. For one thing, people hear vaccine, they think prophylactic vaccine, prevent the disease. Yeah, that's what most of our vaccines are. Doesn't have to be. We can have a therapeutic vaccine. You already have the disease. It's a little tough in the case of flu because it's a little hard to get the immune system working that quickly. But in the case of slower diseases like cancer, we can give you a therapeutic vaccine. You already have the problem. The question is, what are the antigens? We don't have one antigen like flu and hepatitis B have. Every person has their own antigens. Every cancer cell has their own antigens. So where can we find those antigens? Well, we thought, where you could find them? In the cancer. That's a good place. So we have patients with lymphoma who have tumors sticking out. They are superficially accessible. Instead of bringing together the antigen and the immune stimulant in a factory and putting them into a bottle, why don't we just bring them together here at the site of the cancer? There is a precedent for this. It is called, and you guys may know this, Benihana. Some of you are familiar with this great idea. you don't have to make the food in the back. You can just, at the table. That is called in situ Japanese food. It is made at the site of where you eat it. They don't bring out your dinner. They bring out the ingredients, and then they make your dinner. And that is what we are trying to do here. We already have the ingredient, the tumor antigens we want, the immune stimulant, bring them together at the table and try to get people's immune systems to recognize that. And that's what we've been working on for now many years. This is when I was working in California for 9 years on this first approach. And we actually brought toll-like receptors right into the person's tumor. We injected them with a needle, tried to turn on their tumors so they could present antigens to T cells. Also, there were a few dendritic cells in those tumors. Turn on the T cells to recognize that, get the T cells activated. We read out activation by some molecules that they spit out. And this is how we did it. We would give a tiny bit of what we called baby dose radiotherapy, just enough to get a few cancer cells to die. So about a tenth of standard radiation dose, pretty gentle. Inject these immune stimulants right into the tumor and then look to see, I mean, this is gonna melt that tumor. That's cheating. Even a little bit of radiation can melt some of these tumors. But if we see tumors far away that did not get zapped, melting away, that we believe is from teaching their immune system how to recognize that. And this is the first 15 people. We had some people that got partial and complete remissions. They were happy about that. Some of those remissions went on for years. This is one of those patients, big tumor, retroperitoneally. We injected this person far away at the top of their left groin. Tumor far away melted after therapy. These are their immune cells turning on. I'm going to skip it for the sake of time. And that's what we did in Stanford, and now we came to Mount Sinai to try to make this better. And how did we make it better? We thought that, you know, Ralph Steinman won that Nobel Prize for a good reason. These dendritic cells are important, but there are very few of them in a tumor. What can we do about that? Number one, we can complain, we can kvetch, we can lament the fact that they're not there. But after that, you know, those are not that helpful. So what else can we do? We can now inject a medicine that makes you have more dendritic cells. FLT3L is the primary differentiation factor of dendritic cells. You guys know erythropoietin, it makes red blood cells. Some of you know GCSF, it makes neutrophils. FLT3L makes dendritic cells. EPO used to be great until Lance Armstrong, but the concept is still a great concept. We have things that can make the immune cells we want. We put dendritic cells into the tumor using this medicine. We activate them with a different toll-like receptor agonist. It looks like viral RNA. Now we have a lot of activated dendritic cells. We can really turn on these T cells. We can make them proliferate and go out and cure cancer everywhere. Same trial, but now we inject FLT3 into the tumor beforehand. And I'm going to skip this. This is the punchline, really. Patient looking coronally or transversely, such a gigantic tumor that maybe we are not radiologists, but we still know if you have a left jugular vein, you should have a right jugular vein, unless there's a giant tumor squishing it closed, and you can see that transversely. Giant tumor squishing these vessels closed. This is what open round vessels look like. This is what squished blood vessels look like. Also, he had giant tumors external iliac at the top of his pelvis. We treated him far away from any of these sites, and again, the left groin as well. And now melted away of that tumor. Now he's got jugular veins on both sides. I mean, this guy had a lump that when he walked in the room, you could see he had a giant tumor sticking out of his face. Now he doesn't. These tumors melted away. These pelvic tumors melted away. This is his blood, and I'm just going to tell you the punchline of it. He has lymphoma, but some of those lymphoma cells are in the blood, leukemic phase lymphoma. In fact, his blood was full of them. And again, we didn't inject his blood. We injected his tumor, and we see those cancer cells melting away. And then months after we stopped the vaccine, continuing to melt away. So that is living medicine. It is medicine that's working long after we've stopped the medicine, just like the, you know, pneumonia and flu vaccines we give to all the rest of our patients. And this is showing that his cancer cells are melting away, but as opposed to chemotherapy, his other immune cells are actually increasing in proportion. So they are killing cancer cells without killing healthy T cells. And this is actually the exact same data, but looking at cancer cells, cancerous B cells, because these lymphomas are cancerous B cells, versus healthy B cells. Almost all the B cells in his blood are cancerous B cells, tiny number of healthy B cells. We could give him rituximab antibody. It would kill his cancerous B cells, and it would kill his healthy B cells at the same time. Not ideal. Somehow, while we were killing his cancerous B cells, this is the same data as above, just shown in a different way, actually his healthy B cells are increasing in proportion. Somehow we're getting the immune system to recognize a cancerous B cell versus a healthy B cell and kill the one and spare the other. That's really the punchline of the talk. I'm not, you thought I was going to talk about mice in the context of family medicine grand rounds, but that would be crazy. Guys, I appreciate your time. I think I'm supposed to end on this slide because it's the most uplifting one. Thank you very much.
So who do we refer to you, and who do we refer to traditional oncologists, how much are the traditional oncologists who are making oodles of money giving people chemotherapy for oodles of time, how much are they threatened by this stuff that might be like, we give you one injection and then...
Yeah, it's a good question. I asked Steve Gruenstein how threatened he is by me, and he's a big guy. I don't know. He said not very. But I think it's because he's already been doing this for many years and he's fine. We're not good enough yet. We need to get better. But Steve Gruenstein and these other regular oncologists who are good guys helping people a lot are giving immunotherapy, FDA standard approved immunotherapy. So they are giving, this sounds mean, but it's not my intention. They are giving 5 years ago as immunotherapy because we invented those things 15 years ago and got them FDA approved 5 years ago. We are trying to give 5 years from now's immunotherapy. We're trying to give 2022 immunotherapy because that's the trials we have now, are things that look so promising that we think they'll be FDA approved, but that takes 5 years, I mean, at the bare minimum. So who do you send to us? The answer is everybody. Dr. Gruenstein's a great guy and he's a good doctor, and if I got cancer, I'd feel comfortable with him. But if you want to do better than standard, you come and meet us, and then we say to you, you know, the thing we're gonna give you is the same as the standard thing, so you don't have to get it here. We get paid a salary no matter how many patients we see. So come here or go across the street if it's easier, do whatever, it's okay. But to other people we say, we're gonna give you something here that you are not gonna get anywhere else in the world or anywhere else in New York or whatever, so you should stay here with us. And we, you know, in that way, triage patients kind of honestly, because I get paid the same either way. So the answer is everybody. You should send everybody.
One more question. If people don't respond to this, has that impeded in any way their ability to get more traditional therapy?
Yeah, it's a very good question. I mean, that's always a concern with every therapy, is what's the risk-benefit? What bridges are you burning? You know, are you bridging sensitivity? Are you burning the bridge of sensitivity to some other therapy? Our observation has been no with most of these immune therapies. These people are comparably chemosensitive or radiosensitive or so forth. You know, they are mechanistically so distinct that if a cancer cell learns how to avoid immunotherapy, those same tricks do not work usually in avoiding chemotherapy and so forth. So we see that cross-resistance of one chemo versus another chemo, even though they're different, there's a lot of overlap. We don't see much of that cross-resistance in these different modalities. So yeah, we don't think we have burning bridges there. Good question, thank you. Other questions for me? I can answer questions about cancer, or obviously I can answer questions about fashion, because I mean, obviously look at me. Yes?
You mentioned in your vaccines about the opportunity for prevention, and I'm wondering if chronic cancers are type specific or whatever, that there's no opportunity for implementing something that can activate T cells or whatever and come up with preventative opportunity, irrespective of what the cancer type.
There are some opportunities there. Although I said every cancer is unique like a snowflake or a fingerprint, it's not completely true. There are some common things amongst many cancers. You know, a vast majority of breast cancers have certain things. For example, things like estrogen receptors, you know, 60-something percent of breast cancers have some of the same things. So people are trying to immunize people before they get some of these cancers against those common things. We have some early success with that. The even more common type is not what we call primary prophylaxis, but secondary prophylaxis. You had a little intestinal condyloma or something, and that was gonna become cancer, but you cut it out, it's not, but that risk of cancer coming back is higher. Or even just you cut out an early stage cancer, you cut out stage one colon cancer, so vaccinate that person now. You are vaccinating them against recurrence or a second cancer. So we have some examples of prophylactic vaccines, because we have some instances where there are common antigens across all the cancers. So we have some opportunities for that. There is a famous tumor immunologist at Pittsburgh who is working on that for breast cancer. So some opportunities, but not universal opportunities. Good question. Good question.
I'm just wondering about the language that we're using, because, you know, hearing this, I'm trying to figure out, how do I explain this to patients?
Yeah.
And so, for example, the term vaccine is a confusing one. And just the way in which sophisticated immunology is being applied to common conditions, and how we in primary care can help explain that to people. There's obviously, this is happening with all chronic diseases. So I'm wondering, just using sort of vaccine as sort of an example, I can see from immunologist perspective that makes sense.
Yep.
But, you know, as we're trying to make these technologies and therapies available to people, you know, there's a different way even of thinking about this.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the example I gave is a very high hurdle to, the word vaccine very plainly in your mind means flu vaccine, means prevent it before you get it, it means preventative vaccine, and then I'm saying there's this other thing called therapeutic vaccine, take my word on it, but you can't, it's hard to go against the grain of, you know, a lifetime worth of what that word means. So we don't have to, we can just, you know, broadly say immune therapies, and I will say the catchphrases of get your own immune system to kill your own cancer is beloved by patients. Because they fly from all over the country when they hear there's a clinical trial of, because the reason is, it is empowering to them, because they normally hear, I'm going to be the recipient of some poison, which is what we do, but now they hear the other side of it, I'm going to be the fighter, my immune cells are going to be fighting the cancer, and they love the idea of I'm going to do it, because some of our patients feel unempowered by cancer, because they get forced to sit in a chair and do this and do whatever we tell them every 3 weeks, don't violate the calendar. And now they feel empowered that they are part of the battle. So, you know, those are the phraseologies I use of just immune-based therapies, getting your own immune system to kill cancer. And that, you know, without more detail, is usually inspirational.
Well, people come actually wanting, you know, they'll come in a private care visit and say, can you help my immune system? Because I've been, you know, this is, had bronchitis 3 times.
Yep.
Where, so I think that's a helpful way of trying to explain this to people.
Yep, and there we are victims of our own jetpacking because, you know, GNC told them that we can do that, and they lied, it's okay. I tell them a story about a young physician scientist, a very handsome one, who ate that kind of Chinese cabbage every day for 2 weeks, nothing but it, and tested his own blood before and afterwards to see if he got more of the thing that that thing promises to give you. It was undetectable. You could not see the difference, and that was with a lot of bok choy. I mean pounds of it. As opposed to the milkshake that they give you at Jamba Juice, which is just yogurt. So, you know, tell them that they are allowed to eat any of these things that GNC sells them if they can afford it. Yeah, they are not required at GNC to prove that there's any reality to that. But, you know, we're living in a world of alternate truths, so they can enjoy it if it's not hurting them. Yeah. Guys, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.